Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Crow Cycle 2 by Dem Mikhailov. Translated by Vera Klink. Narrated by Roman Howell. Chapter 1. A harsh master for harsh lands. A very harsh master indeed. Oh no, no, no. 2 180-pound bags of wheat flour, good quality. 3 180-pound bags of rye flour, good quality. 70 pounds of rice, regular, white. Pearl barley, 70 pounds. Millet, 70 pounds. Oats, 360 pounds. Pot barley, 360 pounds. Oak barrel filled to the brim with thick, tasty molasses. Ashen barrel full of buckwheat honey, delicious. 35 pounds of black tea. 35 pounds of green tea. 35 pounds of coffee beans. 35 pounds of fine salt. 35 pounds of coarse salt. Various spices, regular ones, in small bags and packets, about 10 pounds, expensive. 360 pounds of young potatoes. 20-liter copper cauldron, shiny. 5-liter copper cauldron, glittering. 25 regular copper spoons. 25 regular copper forks. 25 regular copper soup bowls. 25 regular copper 1-liter mugs. Beer, pale ale, 100-liter barrel. Fresh stuff, not bad. Beer, dark lager, 100-liter barrel. Fresh stuff, not bad. Beer, 2 10-liter pitchers, hidden in baskets lined with straw. Good quality, for the captain. Anthracite of good quality, 180 pounds. A few personal items packed into a bag of thick cloth and labeled For Mr. Crow. That was it. Everything got crossed off the list. All the money set aside for purchases went towards placing the order. The dwarf had no intention of touching his rainy day fund. In fact, he couldn't imagine doing so even in his worst nightmare. His rainy day fund was by definition for emergencies only. He would only spend his emergency money as a very last resort. Purchasing flour, beer, and mugs did not fit into that category by any stretch of the imagination. It was a rather random assortment of items. Not everything on the list got ordered. Many things got missed. Even more things did not get missed, but were simply inaccessible at this time. In any case, the results weren't bad, especially considering the arrival of 2 temporarily hired specialists. It would be good to hire them permanently, though.
Grubber, grumbled a bearded old guy with a bald pate, introducing himself.
His clothes were simple but clean. On his belt hung a long knife. On his back was a large sack with loudly clanging contents.
Phew, getting here is hard.
I'm Crow, the dwarf introduced himself with a smile. I'm glad you've reached the outpost safely. A good cook is always welcome here.
I'm Woodman,
mumbled the second old guy with an equally sour expression. He was dressed in similar fashion, but in slightly darker clothes. He had the same bald pate, except his beard was thinner and grew in clumps.
I'm a brother of his, and he's right. The road is awful, as if lame orcs had trodden all over it.
Thank you for answering my call, nodded Crow in turn, continuing in his role of gracious host. We really need an experienced carpenter here. Follow me, you must be tired. You can sit down and I'll pour you a couple of pints of beer. After a long journey, it's just what you need.
Master, maybe I can have a pint too? Smiled Prochorus hopefully,
as he unloaded the bags and barrels with the other workers and carried them into the main area.
I'll pour some for everyone, said the dwarf, deciding not to argue. Everyone can have some. As soon as you finish with unloading, we'll sit down at the table together. Thankfully, it's almost dinner time.
And hurry up, too,
hoarsely urged the carriage driver, who was standing next to the draft horses. Pulling off his cap, he beat it against his knee to shake off the dust.
May I offer you a pint? Asked the dwarf immediately, throwing an imperceptible glance at the contents of the 2 other wagons.
The small convoy that had arrived at the Grey Peak outpost was composed of 4 large, sturdy carts.
the contents of the first two carts belonged to Crow. The other two loads were intended for someone else. Among the contents of the other carts were a whopping 4 barrels of beer. Judging by the logo of a winking horned elf with his tongue sticking out, the beer was from the same rural brewery called Abel and Gabber. The next question was how to claim these barrels for himself. The last caravan had departed not long ago, and Crow now had a fair amount of copper and some silver for the purchase of the desired beer. If the beer was already intended for someone else, then his attempts to purchase it would be fruitless. But perhaps the convoy men themselves did a bit of selling on the side. That would explain why the beer barrels were not covered with sackcloth, but instead exposed to the curious looks of passerby. It's as if they were saying, "Here is the beer, feel free to take it, if you have the money. And if you don't, then you'll have to settle for licking your lips with your parched tongue and attempting to drill through the oaken sides of the barrel with your agonized stare." He really wanted to buy out the beer, but this wasn't the right moment. No sooner had the last sack been taken off the cart and left on a small patch of cleared ground than all 4 of Crow's workers dashed towards the kitchen, clamoring happily. They hastily took their seats at the table, greedily eyeing the nearest barrel of beer. Coincidentally, it was the one with dark lager. Crow decided not to torment his workers and gave a brief nod to the dwarf named Trout, the most intelligent of the 4. He can be trusted to tap a beer keg. Trout busied himself with the barrel, calling up Serg for help. Meanwhile, the 2 brothers, the cook and the carpenter, sat down at the table. These 2 old guys had a history. Typically, nobody hires them, as far as Crow managed to find out from talking to a group of carpenters that happened to pass through the outpost. It was exactly this group that the 2 brothers had worked with last time. It's also where they got fired from. This happened for several reasons. First of all, Grubber and Woodman always worked together. They were inseparable, like Siamese twins. Yet it wasn't always that a cook and a carpenter were both required in the same place. Secondly, both brothers were constantly frowning and grumbling. They could not be expected to smile even on the most perfect of days. Lastly, and most importantly, neither of them were great shakes at either cooking or carpentry. The tables and benches that Woodman built were quite sturdy. They were also somewhat crooked and ugly. Grubber could fry up some fish or meat or make soup, and the food will turn out edible, but nothing more than that. For all the above reasons, Grubber and Woodman nearly always turned out to be free for hire. The undemanding Crow used this fact to his advantage. A cook and a carpenter were both ideal for his needs. He wasn't looking for fine furniture or rare delicacies fit for kings. Nonsense! What he really needed was simple, nutritious food prepared daily, as well as sturdy tables, benches, and other uncomplicated country-style furniture. Several minutes after the successful unloading of the carts, the overflowing table grew noisy with chatter. The workers and the convoy men were happily discussing topics of interest to Waldirus locals. In fact, all gaming guides strongly recommend listening in to such conversations. It was an incredibly important source of the most unexpected information. There were countless times when, in this manner, players found out the location of a bandit gang, or a dangerous beast, which provinces suffered from famine, and where the king suddenly increased sales taxes. Sometimes they even discovered completely new, unexplored locations. Travelers are curious folk. Their sharp eyes are constantly on the lookout, spotting many things. There's a black hole over there, an entrance to a cave, perchance, or maybe an ancient tomb that opened after the last earthquake. And over there is a strange stone sticking out of the eroded ground, which looks more like the tip of a roof. And here is a footprint of some huge, unknown beast. It only set its foot down once, squashing flat a small village of a dozen houses. And over there, on the reef, you can see the hull of a sunken ship. Maybe there is some gold or other things left in the cargo hold. And so on and so forth. But Crow had no time for listening to rumors. Not here, and not right now. Naturally, he had future plans for listening into them. There is no avoiding rumors, but that's for later. Sipping beer from his brand new mug, he looked thoughtfully at the already unloaded purchases and cast greedy glances at the barrels of someone else's beer. He sighed. Today, 3 more convoys were expected to arrive. All of them will be staying overnight. The beer would get sold out in no time, especially if it's fresh and cold. On the tightly pressed planks of the wooden barrels, Crow could see magic runes. Judging by the square signature, or more accurately, brand mark, the barrels were enchanted by a player runologist. It seems he was working to raise his credentials and reputation, which were both already very good. Otherwise, he wouldn't have been trusted by the famous Abel and Gaber Brewery, which was owned by 2 dwarf brothers after whom the company was named. All beer manufactured by them gave +3 endurance by default, and if the beer was drunk from the brewery's brand name Stone Mug, then this number increased to +5. The bonus lasted an hour, which was plenty of time to finish a lot of tasks, especially if you are a beginner player running around in a noob location. Then you'd have to wait an hour before drinking another liter again to gain the bonus, and this cycle can be repeated as many times as necessary. It was from this brand name mug, which cost 5 silver coins, that Crow was sipping his dark lager. The mug was massive, heavy, and made of stone. It featured the round logo of the brewery that showed 2 frowning bearded dwarf faces with the words Abel and Gaber written above them. From now on, he will use it to drink beer daily. Before heading out to the next raid, +5 points of endurance would be quite handy. Plus, the beer tastes good. Additionally, Crow aimed to unlock 2 special achievements, which could only happen if he followed certain rules. Client of Abel and Gaber is an achievement that is given only if you drink at least 2 mugs of beer daily, using the brewery's brand name mug, for a whole month. 31 days multiplied by 2 mugs, that's 62 liters of beer. As soon as the last 1-liter mug is emptied, you'll instantly unlock an achievement and get a special reward, a permanent +2 endurance and +1 wisdom. Additional rewards include +1 reputation with the brewery, which doesn't really give you much. However, if you are a merchant and regularly buy their beer, the increase in reputation gives you a small discount. Moreover, for unlocking this achievement, you receive a stone figurine of one of the founders, either Abel or Gaber, with the ever-present mug in their hands. These figurines are a collectible item that can be often seen on the shelves of any tavern or pub found across the entire world of Waldira. Loyal client of Abel and Gaber will be given if you continue to drink the brewery's beer out of their special mug for 3 months straight. No exceptions. The mug seems to be a special controlling artifact that records who drinks out of it and how often. During these 3 months, you cannot consume any beer made by competitors, whether real or hypothetical ones. That is, you cannot even enjoy a pint of homemade beer, not even in the smallest village located on the edge of civilization. Not at all. This stipulation was the source of many scandals. Imagine drinking 2 liters of Abel and Gaber beer daily for 90 days straight, and then, in your last or second-to-last mug, you had beer from a completely different brewery. The achievement would come crashing down. You'd have to start all over again. Often, the wrong beer was slipped in by other players for a laugh, or out of envy, or rivalry. Crow was not the only one who bought beer in modest wholesale amounts from the famous brewery. The achievement permanently gave an additional +3 endurance and -1 wisdom. In other words, wisdom fell by 1 point. It wasn't particularly important, though kind of funny. Additionally, the player received another collectible stone figure of either Abel or Gaber. Sometimes this completed the collection comprising of only 2 items. Another +1 reputation with the brewery also cannot be discounted. The Sly Dwarf got the brand name mug for free for being a customer who purchased the beer wholesale for the first time, taking 2 barrels at once. Crow had no plans of ever giving this mug to anyone. No way. it was going to be his personal mug for beer. The part about the beer was no joke either. In fact, it was quite literal. The mug was specifically for beer. If you pour anything else into it, the mug might crack. If you pour milk into it, the mug will shatter into hundreds of little pieces. Whether the owners of the brewery suffered from milk allergies, or whether it was some kind of long-standing enmity with ranchers, the reason was unknown.
"Good beer, eh?"
snorted the head of the convoy contentedly. He approached Crow and was wiping foam off his mustache.
"Just like that stuff."
He innocently pointed his finger, which was still wet from beer, at the barrels lying in the cart. "It sure is," agreed Crow. "That's the reason I bought it. I'd buy more, but..."
"I'll sell it to you," said the convoy man at once. "That beer is from the same batch as yours, my friend. You can't go wrong."
"What about the price?"
"The road to here was difficult. Potholes and bumps, and the carts ain't rented, nor the horses borrowed. The price needs to be fair to account for all this."
"And I want to be fair. As long as you don't overcharge, good sir, then we can come to an agreement. So, how much do you want for the beer?"
"Are you taking all of it?"
"As much as you have."
"Well then."
The seller and buyer parted ways about 10 minutes later. They parted on good terms. The dwarf waved goodbye to the carts, shouting wishes for their soonest return as they left. Behind the dwarf stood 4 barrels in a row. They were decorated with the image of a horned elf, even though the brand name mugs had a picture of 2 sullen dwarves. This was yet another mystery of the Abel and Gaber Brewery, which was founded by dwarves who traditionally dislike elves, even horned ones. But Crow wasn't a fan of sticking his nose in other people's business, so he simply stood and smiled, waving his hand and thinking of 400 more liters of fresh beer. For every barrel, the convoy man got 3 gold coins. At the brewery, 100 liters of beer cost 2 gold plus another 4 silvers for the container. Beer is widely known for its cheapness, among other things. In total, Crow now had 200 liters, plus another 400. That's 600 mugs of beer. Naturally, a part of the beer will rapidly flow into the perpetually parched throats of Crow's workers, but that can't be helped. Moreover, as a diligent master, the dwarf planned to give out the beer slightly more generously than was agreed upon. He didn't want his workers to consider him a miser or to spread such rumors about him across Waldira. There's nothing worse than being known as a cheapskate among locals. The only thing left was to come up with a price. Considering that the outpost was in a perpetual state of rush hour, he didn't have much time to think. He needed to come to a decision quickly. 1 silver per liter, murmured the black-haired dwarf after making some simple calculations. In large letters, he wrote "Fresh Beer" on a board sign, adding below it in equally large writing, "From Abel and Gaber Brewery." Crow hung the board sign in the most visible spot, over the market stand. He quickly dragged almost all the barrels to the spot and covered them with a pile of animal skins to keep the beer cool. Then he dumped a couple of jugs of water over top for the same goal. He refused to rely entirely on the freezing magic cast on the barrels. Some guards who were passing by slowed down sharply. Apparently, they were literate, as they could perfectly recognize 2 important words, fresh and beer, when written in any language. "For guards, the beer is always free," stated the dwarf, sufficiently loudly, but without any smugness or pretentiousness. Smiling calmly, he watched the guards halt and added, "With the permission of the captain, of course." The brave soldiers nodded energetically and gulped in unison, eyes traveling over the sign again. Then they continued on their way.
"What should we do now, master?"
inquired Serg in his deep, low voice. Serg's wide back almost completely obscured Proc, who was wiping his mouth behind him.
"Logging," answered the dwarf shortly, picking up 2 thick wooden clubs off the ground. "We need more logs, guys. Together, we cut, fell, and drag back trees until nightfall."
"Will do,"
promised the half-orc, satisfied.
But what about the jackals and their friends? Not that we're afraid of them, but still.
I'm coming with you, Crow assured him, casting an extremely angry look in the direction of the territory outside the Grey Peak outpost. You focus on cutting trees, and I'll keep watch.
Well, that's all right then,
sighed Proc with relief, while the others nodded in agreement.
Within the last 2 days, all four workers had seen for themselves that their master Crow was strict, fair, and did not throw empty words to the wind. If he said he'll keep watch, then he'll do it, and that's that. There was nothing to worry about anymore. Soon, their small group left the outpost, stepping outside the invisible boundary of the protected territory. There were two unknown players in the surrounding area. Both were human. Both were approximately level 40, warriors, swordsmen, wearing the same belts and carrying the same weapons. Crow suspected that he knew which quest the pair of swordsmen had recently completed, for which they received the weapons. Right now, they were thoughtfully staring at a map, trying hard to work something out. Behind them stood a wooden cart hitched to a gray donkey. Crow could not see what was inside the cart, as it was tightly covered with canvas and bound by ropes. However, he did not need to see it. If the dwarf was right about the swords received for the quest, then he also knew the next task in the quest chain. It involved delivering nearly a half ton of poison against Grutomycels to a certain one-legged, bad-tempered grandpa. Meanwhile, nobody had ever actually seen these so-called Grutomycels. Nonetheless, the grandpa kept buying and buying the poison in any amounts, while generously compensating for it with orange honey and nectar bread. Buttercorn Village is that way, pointed out the dwarf as he passed by the players, who were deep in thought. That's another 2 hours from here, guys. Oh, they looked up and chorused. Thank you. They had the same face. That is, they were identical. Even their hair was combed the same way. They must be brothers. Twins, specifically. No problem, said the dwarf dismissively. Good luck. Just keep to the road, guys. I know it whines insanely, but don't even think about cutting across the cornfields. Thank you, repeated the players in unison, whose names were Loco Floco and Moco Floco. We've already been warned. Good luck, repeated the dwarf, and kept going. He did not look back, although his thoughts swirled lazily around the two look-alike warriors. Are they really brothers? Or did they just decide to use the bonus for twins? When twins act together, they get a small bonus in the form of a couple of special skills, but that was none of his business. He had other things besides the swordsman brothers to occupy his thoughts. For example, finding and eliminating his current problem. The animals inhabiting this location did not touch Crow's workers. The physically powerful laborers, who easily felled fairly thick trees in a few swings, were more than the animals could handle. Yesterday, however, it all changed when Serg caught a small present, a crooked arrow that got stuck in his broad green back. The arrow had come out of nowhere and was tipped with a rather nasty poison. The tough half-orc managed to get back to the outpost, where he immediately received medical treatment from the guards. Crow, who was standing beside them, wrote a note to himself to acquire several healing potions and antidotes ASAP. After questioning Serg, the guards were outraged. They immediately saddled their horses and combed the surrounding area several times, all without results. They found strange animal tracks deeply imprinted into the ground. The greatest amount of these prints was found near the memorable little lake with fresh water. The strange creatures must have come for a drink. But they can't be the ones who shot the arrow, right? As for the other tracks, more suitable to an archer with a bow, the guards didn't find any at all. Not unless you counted the multitude of footprints from humans, dwarves, elves, and others. However, the arrow was very peculiar. It was so crudely made that no archer would agree to shoot it from his bow. But let's go back to the strange animal tracks. The captain's face clouded up when the guards described to him the tracks they had found. Moreover, he personally rode down to the little lake to examine the paw prints. His expression darkened even more at what he saw.
The player decided not to ask him any questions. They may be friends, but the captain did not seem keen to socialize at the moment. Instead, the old warrior locked himself inside the tower and began to write messages, one after another, sending them by bird mail. And what was the point of asking anyway? Crow was no professional tracker, obviously. But he did see the arrow. When he heard about the animal tracks, the rest became clear. Trouble had come upon them. Especially considering the captain's recent words about gray orcs and their planned mass attack. Although, the ones who had come to visit weren't the scary gray wolves themselves. That is, it wasn't the orcs, but their much more harmless neighbors. Get to work, ordered Crow shortly, stopping at the notable hill with regrown trees, which was beside the stone peak crowned by the eagle nest. Speaking of eagles, far, far above in the skies flickered a tiny dot. It was Chris. The eagle had begun to fly much higher and much faster once he had grown in level within the last couple of days. As a result, the black-haired dwarf could now find out in advance about the approach of new caravans and convoys, even without the help of the guards. Sometimes, he even found out about the visitors sooner than the guards, and was the one to bring them the news, which was deeply appreciated by the warriors. That's why Crow chose such an unusual creature for the dwarfish race to be his pet, in order to be always aware of what's going on around the Gray Peak outpost. In order to know what is happening near his home. In the future, Chris will have the opportunity to acquire another skill or two aimed specifically at scouting. That's what the dwarf will select. The second advantage of the feathered pet is his eyesight. It is truly sharp and fitting of an eagle. The third advantage of an eagle is his ability to live in the air, unlike many other birds. He can spread his huge wings and soar slowly in the blue skies, while keeping a sharp eye on the faraway ground below. There are other perks, but Chris wouldn't achieve them for a long time. Meanwhile, Crow had enough on his plate to worry about, what with the mysterious tracks, whistling arrows, and the steady stream of arriving travelers. With abrupt and moist-sounding crackling, a spruce tree shuddered and began to tilt. 2 seconds later, the tree trunk hit the ground, breaking and bending its branches.
Timber!
Hollered Prochorus way too late, his call echoing loudly as he stared at Crow, eyes popping in panic. He missed the moment again, the bloody moron. Crow said nothing, but shook his heavy fist threateningly in Proc's direction. Unable to suppress his anger completely, he added, Prochorus, if you do that again, I'll take away your beer.
Master, take away my water instead. Don't touch the beer, Master. Beer is holy. It's sacred, like. You drink some, and it's like you've been born again,
whined Prochorus piteously, staring at the player with puppy-like eyes.
Pay attention, scolded the dwarf again.
Then he turned away, not looking as the warriors surrounded the fallen spruce and began to strip it down. What was there to watch anyway? It was a common sight for him. He should keep an eye on their surroundings instead. The workers were making a lot of noise. The chopping sounds of their axes could be heard far away and by many ears. Although with workers like Proc, one also needs eyes on the back of their head in order to avoid being squashed by a falling tree. The clumsy worker kept doing it, even though Crow already told him 10 times that he needs to shout loudly several seconds before the tree falls, in order to prevent anyone getting hit by the falling trunk. But Prochorus was painfully slow. Every time, the fool would yell after the chopped down tree hit the ground. That's the downside to cheap workers. They were diligent, strong, tough, brave, but so stupid. Some of them showed a bit of promise in the intellectual department, but it was too early to judge.
Over there!
Startled, Crow looked up momentarily. Soaring high above, Chris had let out a thin shriek. The only one who heard it was the stout, black-haired player dwarf. A brief message flashed across the virtual interface. In much more human language, it informed him that something was moving towards them. Based on the direction indicated by the blinking red arrow, It was coming from a nearby clump of bushes that framed a small ditch.
"Keep working, guys," repeated the dwarf calmly.
Then he rushed ahead, running as fast as he could and looking like a short-legged Olympic sprinter. Thankfully, the distance was puny, only about 300 feet. The dwarf did not cross the distance in record time. However, he was sufficiently quick that the enemy had no time to hide again. His breaking distance turned out to be about 6 feet, as the dwarf literally plowed his heels into the soil and last year's layer of pine needles on the ground. Not bothering to right his balance, he crashed down on his back. 2 zigzagging arrows whizzed past his face. The dwarf jumped up in time to see an enraged feather meteor dive into the bushes that covered the ditch. The attempt on his master's life made Chris quite upset. The furious screech of the predatory bird, the crunch of branches. Out of the ditch came nasally yelling. However, the real show began when the dwarf crashed in after the eagle, equally angry and carrying a huge hammer in his hands. Crow's wild roar shook the trees. 2 powerful kicks sent 2 large, fine-leaved shrubs rocketing skywards as the dwarf cleared some legroom for himself and the eagle. The next shrub shot up into the air, soaring in an arc and out of sight. A large boulder flew 30 feet upwards, then came crashing straight down. A sharp squeal informed everyone that the projectile did not land on empty ground, but at the minimum on someone's foot or paw. The leaves and nearby area were generously sprayed by yellow-green liquid. The rest of the miraculously spared vegetation crackled and swayed as in a raging storm. Through the cracking of branches and roots came the snarling voice of the dwarf.
"Why, you stinking gladioli! Why, you shitty thistles! I'll rip all your leaves off and stuff them into your plant butts! I'll fertilize you with your own brains! I'll rip your jaws apart and tear out your roots! I'll turn you and your kids into burdocks! Shoot at my workers again, will you? Will you? Will you?"
Each shout was accompanied by heavy slapping and smacking sounds of hitting. The eagle screeched in agreement. A couple of times, he rose 60 feet into the air and, similarly to the previously mentioned boulder, plunged down like a winged wrestler. The workers, who were standing by the hill, froze in shock as they watched the insanity unfold before them.
"Angering master is a bad idea," observed Trout thoughtfully.
"Yeah," agreed Serg.
"And don't get in his way when he's angry," added Prochorus, nodding energetically. "Don't make the birdie mad either."
He gave a shuddering gulp as he watched Chris take off, his talons clutching the shredded remains of something green. For some reason, the fragments twitched spastically and gave off high-pitched squeals that sounded like a strangled,
"Oh no, no, no!"
Chris rose very, very high into the skies, released his grip, waited for a few seconds, then dived after his falling victim, hurtling down like a feathered comet. The green clump of shreds, which was still squealing,
"Oh no, no, no!"
flopped onto the ground. Then it got struck by the eagle. And after that, everything was silent. The show was over. The dwarf stepped out of the substantially thinned bushes. He was smeared head to foot with green goo. Staring at his workers, he asked in surprise,
"Why aren't you working?"
"We are working."
"Already working?"
"We're working hard, master, real hard,"
chorused the workers in reply. They attacked the felled spruce tree with axes, instantly turning the poor log into fine splinters that could only be used for kindling. The dwarf spat angrily on the ground and returned to the bushes, throwing his pet back into the air as he went. Chris shot like an arrow into the sky and soared high above the clouds again. Meanwhile, Crow clambered into the thick of the brush where the fight had taken place. There, the stout dwarf fell to his knees and pressed his hands into the soil that got dug up during the heat of the battle. No, Crow did not intend to say a prayer, neither in thanks nor in repentance. He wasn't looking for tracks either. On the contrary, he was frantically trying to conceal them. It wasn't due to fake modesty that Crow was doing his best to hide them. He was trying to erase the traces of the monsters that he had destroyed. He was burying 2 conically shaped, 3-foot-deep holes. At the bottom of these holes, among shards of wild rocks, tangles of roots, and loose soil, a totally different kind of stone fragments was visible. These shards were rectangular, white, yellow, red, gray, with the remains of intricate black lettering on their dirty sides. Bricks. 3 feet deep under the surface lay a fair amount of multicolored brick pieces, which looked extremely old at first glance. And Crow, without showing any excitement or interest in his finding, was carefully and thoroughly burying them back into the ground. A minute later, the broken bricks were covered with soil and dead leaves. After examining the ditch and making sure the inconveniently bright bricks didn't peek through anywhere, the dwarf breathed a sigh of relief. Only then did he leave the place of recent slaughter, remembering to grab several objects from the remains of the squealing monsters he had destroyed. Climbing back out of the bushes, Crow looked for the cleverest of the four workers, the dwarf named Trout. Jabbing his fingers in the direction of the bushes he had just left, he ordered, "Burn it."
"Will do, master."
"Thank you for protecting us,"
added the others in unison, while being careful to continue swinging their axes. Well, aren't they ever so hardworking? Crow hurried back to the outpost, but hurried in his own manner, stopping to pick up mushrooms and large stones along the way. He didn't ignore the large logs that could be used for firewood either. He also killed the occasional rabbit or partridge, and robbed bird nests by gently collecting their eggs. The goods won't just magically appear on his sales table. He already had a plan to vary the selection of items a bit, as well as the future menu. However, it would require additional working hands. Much smarter hands, actually. And that would cost a lot. Thus, he first needed to expand his business, selling what he had and reselling what he had just bought. The enterprising dwarf put a lot of hope in the beer from Abel and Gaber. Every now and then, the player's thoughts kept returning to the recently destroyed enemies. Rock Nepenthes. That's who had come to visit Grey Peak. These carnivorous plants had the form of a strange green or bright red pitcher on four thin, paw-like roots. That is why the plant left behind tracks of a bona fide animal, a fact that would often confuse inexperienced trackers and lead to trouble. Imagine running along, following the tracks of some unknown furry creature. Obviously, you'd be on the lookout for a typical animal with four legs, a tail, fur, two ears, and so on. Meanwhile, the Nepenthes that had left the tracks would simply stop and keep motionless. You will come right up to it. As soon as you do, you will receive a poisonous arrow in your back. Then you'll be grabbed by three or four long, thick vines and stuffed into the readily open mouth of the pitcher. Nom nom. The arrow is released by the plant. The plant grows the arrow inside the pitcher, laces it with self-produced poison, places it on a plant-based bowstring, and shoots it fairly accurately at the target. A large creature would be poisoned and slowed down by the venom, while a smaller animal would be paralyzed outright. And again, nom nom. Rock Nepenthes inhabit rock crevices, an unsurprising fact given their name. According to legend, they were once peaceful plants that were completely harmless and produced delicious nectar for equally peaceful buzzing bees. And then, for some reason, there came a drought that lasted many years. Along came dry winds that blew away all soil, leaving only bare rock. The previously peaceful Nepenthes had to rapidly adjust. They turned aggressive, acquired mobility, started growing arrows and producing poison. It's only a legend, though. In reality, Nepenthes lived in the same areas as gray orcs, and often accompanied them on travels. They seemed to migrate with them. Or maybe they just went along for a delicious snack. Perhaps they were tired of eating tough and bland orcs, and wanted something more tender and sweet. If Nepenthes are around, then gray orcs will soon follow. This wasn't a quiet little alarm bell with a vague hope that it will all blow over. This was a loud, screaming siren with the firm knowledge that there's no chance of blowing over. Damn. Why must there be an orc invasion when he had just purchased fresh beer? Couldn't they have waited at least? Returning home, The player began to unload the contents of his bag onto the spot in front of his well-worn tent. It needed fixing, but he still hasn't gotten around to it. Lamenting his lack of time, Crow grabbed the pitchers of beer, along with the trophies he collected from the Nepenthes, and marched straight to the watchtower to see the captain. From high above, he heard the eagle's high-pitched scream. Someone was coming. To the dwarf's relief, they were traveling from the direction of Algora. Judging by the road they were taking, it was probably another caravan, a messenger, a mailman, or maybe a convoy. But they were definitely friends, not foes. He should start saving up immediately for a couple of special artifacts. He needed the ones that created a bond between an owner and his pet. With the help of this bond, he would be able to easily see what his pet sees. The only thing left was to save up 50 golden coins, which was the price of the cheapest artifact of such nature.
"Everything needs money," complained the dwarf, huffing and puffing as he hurried away. "A penny here, and a penny there, and suddenly you're broke." He shook his head sadly. "I need to start selling horseshoes ASAP. I don't want to keep robbing guilds forever. Oof."
Chapter 2. A harsh government for harsh lands. One that is new and grim. Lots of running around. Mai Tai! It was uncommonly busy inside the watchtower. Too busy. The usual calm and rational captain was quickly moving stacks of paper, pulling open drawers, and taking out bags of coins that he packed into his saddlebag, along with other things.
"Hi, lad," he greeted the dwarf, addressing him in the old familiar way. "Keeping busy?"
"Yeah, good day to you. Where are you going?" asked the player, without concealing his interest.
"My division is being recalled to Algora. They're sending 36 other guards here, headed by a centurion named Vurius. This means trouble for you, lad."
"I don't understand." With a deep sigh, the captain rubbed his own temples vigorously, threw a few more things into his bag, looked Crow in the eye, and began to speak.
"Vurius is a respectable, honest, experienced warrior. A veteran. He took part in many military campaigns and rose to the rank of Kiliarch, a commander of thousands. At that point, he seemed destined for promotion to the next rank and placed upon a white stallion. And then, out of nowhere, he suddenly fell back to the rank of a decurion, a captain of tens. Can you imagine? To come crashing down from a Kiliarch of a northern garrison posted at the capital to the position of a perpetually traveling decurion like me? And nobody knows why. There were so many rumors, it would be impossible to list them all. If I were to write them down, my quill would go blunt, and my ink bottle would dry out and crack. Later on, though, Vurius rose to the rank of a centurion again. But ever since then, he wouldn't get posted near cities. He is always traveling, always riding down dusty roads and beating new paths. But that's not what's important for you. What matters is he cannot stand civilians. He protects them, but he doesn't like them. He firmly believes that civilians should keep their nose out of the military's business. Do you understand now?"
"This is bad news," replied the dwarf grimly. "Very bad."
"I'll say. Not that I would let a civilian call the shots in my army division either. No offense meant there, lad."
"None taken."
"But that's for business related to orders, discipline, punishment, and other internal affairs. As for things like bringing firewood or finishing everyday chores, I'm always grateful for that sort of help, and will give my heartfelt thanks for it. But that's me. Vurius, on the other hand, thinks that guards must take care of their own business, as ordered, and that soldiers should not talk with strangers, as it can only bring trouble. Therefore, this is my advice to you, lad, as a friend."
"Thank you," responded the player sadly, "for calling me your friend."
"Because it's true," smiled the captain, clapping the dwarf on the shoulder. "Very true. We'll see each other again, I'm sure.
Listen, if you have any unfinished business or last requests from me or the others, then I suggest you take care of it now. Vorius will arrive in a couple of hours. He won't interfere in your business, but he certainly won't let you chat with the guards, nor do any work associated with the garrison. The only civilians he'll tolerate are the builders, since soldiers don't have the knowledge to handle this type of construction work. As for you, he'll chase you off mercilessly. He won't care that you're the first settler here. I'll say this for Vorius, though. If anything bad happens, whether it's fire or a raid, then the guards will come to your aid as usual. Vorius takes his duty seriously. That's why, my friend, you should use this time to sit down and think. Remember everything you still need to do. Then start running around like your pants are on fire. Time is not on your side. You only have a little over an hour. If there's anything you need to finish, do it now. Go, hurry.
But I... began Crow, raising the pitcher of beer in his hand.
Impossible, shrugged the old warrior apologetically. There's no time. Go, Crow, go! Time is ticking!
Okay, almost moaned the dwarf, not wanting to hold up the honorable captain any longer. He bolted out onto the street. Once outside, he immediately proceeded to follow the advice of the knowledgeable guard. He plopped his backside on the ground and, putting his head in his hands, began to think hard. What an ugly turn of events. It wasn't just a few things that he still had to finish. He had a ton of plans, big and small, from trivial to great, all connected to the guards. And for all of them, he was given a little over an hour. It seemed appropriate to start wailing in despair. Grinding its digital mental gears, his brain frantically sorted through the plethora of routine tasks associated with the guards. The dwarf quickly realized that he should start with the most materialistic matters, just when he spent his last money on additional beer. His next earnings would not be until late evening, but he needed money now. His first thought, which occurred to him like a flash of lightning in total darkness, the guard's storage room. Crow has slightly outgrown the various widgets and antiques found there. However, extra tools, food, materials, and weapons would be welcome. But even if the guards opened the storerooms, they would only do so after receiving explicit permission from the captain, and the latter is currently extremely busy preparing reports and packing his own things. Distracting him right now would do more harm than good. That's why Crow left the best part, the potential dessert, so to speak, for later. First, he decided to deal with the regular guards, using a tried-and-true method that had been taught to him by one of the player legends from the old days. The method was called Mai Tai, which stood for Mute Amicable Indigenous and Thick Amicable Indigenous. Those who knew about this simple method and had a bit of creativity happily came up with an undeserved name for the technique. They called it Verbal Muay Thai, which absolutely did not correspond with reality. Nevertheless, even Muay Thai had several Dan levels and specialty skills, depending on the situation. The dwarf did not like resorting to this technique. He knew there were incredible pros in this field, although Crow himself was no novice. He used to study the elements of dramatic acting, after all. The technique was simple and had the greatest chance of success if one had a good reputation with his chosen target.
Hi, Luco!
Crow had come up to one of the guards and gave him a huge smile. The dwarf had changed into his noob outfit, barefoot, wearing his first tattered patched shirt, a rope belt, and carrying a shabby basket stuffed with horseshoes and arrowheads of his own creation.
Hi, Crow! Smiled back the soldier.
I heard that you are leaving today.
Yes, we are being replaced by a new shift.
And we'll never see each other again,
finished Crow sadly. He smiled quietly, wiping his eyes with his hand and gazing at the distant horizon.
Oh, don't say that,
said the guard, suddenly flustered.
Maybe we'll meet again. We are always traveling and don't stay in one place for long. We'll see each other again. I hope so,
nodded the dwarf energetically.
The iron objects in his basket clanged loudly as he dug among them and fished out a single horseshoe. "Take this as a souvenir from me, my friend Luco. It's a horseshoe. I made it myself. According to our beliefs, horseshoes bring luck."
The powerfully built warrior accepted the crude horseshoe into his rough-looking palm.
"Thank you, my friend Crow. Thank you."
"As a souvenir," repeated the dwarf. "When you look at the horseshoe, you'll think of me, Luco. Well, I'm off. I need to say goodbye to the others."
"Wait, Crow. Here, take my knife."
Into the player's hand, he stuffed a regular soldier's knife with a thick blade, a handle of rough leather, and a matching sheath.
"Something to remember me by."
"You're kidding. This is too much. I only gave you a simple horseshoe, and you're giving me such a valuable thing."
"Take it. It's a good knife. When you look at it, maybe you'll remember the god, Luco, eh?"
"Yes, of course I'll remember. Thank you very much, Luco. Thank you."
"Off you go, then."
The smiling guard pocketed the horseshoe and continued packing. Crow put away the present to the very bottom of his basket, waved farewell to the kind-hearted soldier, and marched off towards the next guard. As he walked, he tried to limp ever so slightly, dragging his bare feet in the dust while keeping a huge, sincere smile on his face.
"Hey, Horace, my friend!"
The voice of the businesslike dwarf carried across the outpost.
"Is it really true? Are you really leaving, abandoning me here?"
"No, of course not. We're not abandoning you,"
the firm voice of the next victim of Mai Tai reassured the saddened dwarf. And so it went. Considering his excellent reputation and the benefits of being a local settler, the dwarf managed to collect a fairly good tribute from the guards. For every single thing he received, he made sure to gift back some trivial thing that he had forged himself. Crow's haul turned out to be varied, but useful. Knives, belts, boots, spare shirts, hats, short swords, arrowheads for longbows and crossbows. One glowing orb. The departing soldiers weren't stingy and gave generous gifts to the smiling dwarf. Crow immediately set limits on what he should accept. He refused to take a personal amulet that was enchanted to protect against wolves. That was too personal. Taking such an object would have been immoral. The guard might only be an AI-controlled NPC, but for Crow, the lines had become blurred over the past few days. After a little over an hour, Operation Mai Tai concluded with overwhelming success. The dwarf hurried back to the tower, now clutching all his monetary means in his eager little fists. He knocked, peeked inside, and made sure the captain had finished packing, and only then entered, rushing to storm the citadel in the way of his path to the treasure-filled storerooms. It seems that the gods of light themselves had blessed the player, and only 5 minutes later, the captain gave in and allowed him to acquire several settlers' kits, which included various tools, at a laughably cheap cost. The guards sold them for less than their market price, for which the dwarf was extremely grateful and did not conceal his joy. In addition to everything, the captain sold 100-pound bag of wheat flour and a small barrel of pickled tomatoes. Maybe he would have sold more, but Crow had run out of money, and the warrior was not about to start giving away the government's goods for free, but even what he got was pretty good. Besides taking care of his own interests, the player finally had the chance to show the captain the remains of the rock Nepenthes, to tell him about the fight. As it turned out, the captain was already aware. The guards at the top of the watchtower had seen everything and told their superior. Moreover, two archers were ready to loose several arrows if the fight were to suddenly turn unfavorable for the dwarf. The captain had already made his own conclusions too, but decided not to share them. It was a military secret, he explained. Plus, it was now going to be a headache for the arriving centurion. And on that note, they parted. The supplies purchased from the storerooms were quickly transported to the dwarf's property. Soon, the dwarf's tired workers also returned, bringing several logs and bundles of thick branches. Off to the side, the builders were working non-stop on the future barracks. On a regular day, Crow would not have thought of visiting that area,
But now he was forced to take a defensive position. Not a terribly obvious one, but with firm measures. All his laborers received a break from work and plenty of food. Their new cook did not disappoint. The stew turned out to be hearty and sufficiently tasty. The dwarf did not hand out any beer, despite complaints of heat. No way. They would have to wait until evening, no sooner. After mealtime, everyone went back to work. Not wanting to let any of them leave his property, the player ordered them to dig a hole for his personal future pond. Enough! Crow was sick of watching unknown travelers as they caught the fish that he had been feeding up and devoured it right before his eyes. Thus, he commanded his workers to dig deep and dump the soil on top of the hill in order to increase its height and width. The laborers sighed for a bit, of course, but got to work immediately. They may not have been the brightest, but they were hardworking. The dwarf himself was nervously dashing around the fenced-in part of his property, picking up litter here, tidying up there, stacking rocks into neat piles. In other words, he was doing a minor cleanup. He made sure the area around the market stand was uncluttered. No matter how you looked at it, the outpost was about to receive a rather important and capricious new boss. This, of course, was not the governor. However, Centurion was a quite different rank from Decurion. Moreover, as if to spite Crow, either gods or demons have sent not a regular centurion, but a grudge-holding fanatic of military service, if the departing captain's words were true. Thus, the dwarf planned not to draw attention to himself. However, he should still thrive to make a positive impression on any new arrivals to the Gray Peak outpost. They are going to see the property of a neat, hard-working owner, where everything is clean and in order. Crow was definitely not planning to suck up, and he won't be giving anyone the cold shoulder either. If he is greeted, he will greet them back. If he is asked, he will reply. If he isn't asked, then he'll keep his silence. He'll wait a day or two for Centurion Vurius to settle in, take a good look around, and remember the faces of those around him. Only then will he try to get to know him closer. But until then, no way. It would be better to stay neutral. He won't back down, nor rush into battle. Centurion Vurius arrived on time. All 36 soldiers came with their own large train of supply carts, along with 2 caravans that needed accompanying on their way from Algora. The caravans lagged behind the guards, eating dust kicked up by the hooves of horses ridden by the brave soldiers. They did not object, however, as they were enormously glad for any protection in these wild parts of the country. Dust can be brushed off later. The warriors quickly dismounted and headed towards the watchtower, which stood in the center of the outpost. The captain had already left the tower and was striding in the opposite direction. Meanwhile, the caravans moved off to the side, towards the drinking well for horses and other draft animals. Near the well was a large empty area that was specifically set aside for temporary camps. At this point, Crow couldn't hold back, and again stretched his lips in a happy smile. Everything was going according to plan. What plan, you may ask? This morning, as soon as the last caravan left, Crow used the brief break to majorly reorganize the place intended for camping for travelers. The dwarf had divided up the area into non-obvious zones by constructing 12 stone fire pits at an equal distance from each other. Now, all guests, without exception, stopped at the first available fire pit. They no longer had to think about finding the best place or at which old campfire to stop. Understandably, some particularly large convoys may take up 3 or 4 fire pits at once. However, this did not mess up the order. The former chaos, when Crow had to squeeze past animals and angry convoy men to deliver firewood, was totally eliminated. He was proud of coming up with his little trick. While Dyra gradually destroyed his achievements, breaking down the fire pits with wind, rain, and the passage of time, that's why he will have to regularly fix them up. Having dismounted, the guards from Algora immediately went to work, showing some serious discipline. The centurion was nowhere in sight. How would a head honcho typically stand out? Well, He should remain sitting on a stallion, while showing off his plumed helmet, jutting out his jaw, and staring around with the ferocious gaze of a drunken porcupine. And yet, Crow did not see anything of the sort. All of them were even dressed the same. No glimmer of gold or silver anywhere. Damn, did they lose the centurion on their way here? Cursing, Crow ordered the workers to continue. Meanwhile, he dashed to the market stand, grabbing two bundles of firewood along the way. There should be enough firewood waiting by the table prepared for sale. However, a little extra can't hurt.
Beer.
What do you mean, beer?
It says so, croaked a huge half-orc traveler in disbelief. Lidorella's holy breasts, fresh beer!
The heat is going to your head.
It says so right on the sign. Beer! Abel and Gaber!
That's right, hastily confirmed the smiling dwarf, appearing behind the sales table. I've got beer, fresh, light and dark, from the Abel and Gaber Brewery, yesterday's batch. 10 coppers for a pint. Hurry and get yours before it's all gone. Turning aside, he muttered to himself, I gotta think of a better advertisement campaign. On that account, Crow was mistaken. The advertisement fell like pleasantly cool rain on the dusty ears of the weary, suffering travelers.
Ooh,
echoed the collective sound over the outpost. A queue of dust-covered men, dying of thirst, formed instantly behind the market stand. Gulping convulsively in expectation, they looked as if they were about to crumble apart like overbaked clay unless they received a mug of beer immediately. And so it went. Working at top speed, Crow poured beer out of the barrels and accepted money. Silver and copper coins clattered non-stop against the tabletop. Mugs rattled. There was lots of noisy gulping and grateful sighing as the cool beer was instantly sucked up, followed by drawn-out burping and utterly satisfied grunting. The convoy men are simple folk who express their emotions in simple ways. This isn't the Royal Palace, where a light fart is considered national treason. It is worth noting that in the 10 minutes of crazed sales, nobody asked for anything other than beer, neither firewood for hearths, nor supplies of any kind were requested. Just beer, beer, beer. To the tired convoy men's credit, none of them tried to get wasted on the spot. No. Each of them downed about 2 pints of beer, returned the mug, and went back to work. They began to unharness their horses, lead them to the drinking well, scrub their hides, check the carts. In short, they did the sort of routine work that Crow had witnessed many times, which was always done thoroughly and carefully. 10 minutes of sales demolished 100 liters of beer and brought the dwarf exactly 1,000 coppers. It also brought the realization that the 25 mugs he had purchased were nowhere near enough. He needed to acquire at least 25 more. In short, he had earned 10 gold coins in small change and learned a life lesson in the food service industry. Not a bad result. He needs to wash the mugs while he still has time. Hygiene is important. The mugs should be kept squeaky clean. The convoy men were already taking their spots at the campground that Crow had planned out. They were currently busy. Soon, however, their quenched thirst was bound to be replaced by a serious appetite, and then they will visit the market stand again. However, Crow had practically no food left. Even if he managed to find something edible in his stores, it would not be very fresh. The player would never consider offering expired goods to the caravans passing through the outpost. He had not yet gone crazy to the point of trying to sell rotten food. The out-of-stock items were mainly wild forage, local mushrooms, rabbit meat, partridge, etc. On the other hand, this morning, he had received a load of various grains, tea, coffee, and spices. He had the ingredients to make a hearty lunch for the convoy men. He also had the cook Grubber, a grumpy grandpa with a soup ladle, who could easily make porridge or some other simple meals. The only thing left was to decide on the price. And what was there to decide? There wasn't much time for calculations, so for the simplest dish, a bowl of hearty meat stew, he will take 10 coppers.
The meat will come from rabbits and partridges. Harvesting meat from the local mobs was a 15-minute task. Then it can be used to make an incredibly delicious meal. Yes, excellent idea. Everything will turn out perfectly.
That won't work,
stated Grubber categorically, wiping his bald pate with a kerchief.
Why?
Crow nearly cried.
Because there are nearly 5 dozen convoy men, hungry men, huge men. See that pair of half-orcs over there? Each of them can scoff down a triple portion like it's nothing. And I only have a 5-gallon cauldron, added the cook. Even if I were to cook in batches, one right after another, it still wouldn't work. No offense, master, but it's a dumb idea. You cannot feed 50 men from a 5-gallon pot.
Damn, I don't have the money right now for a 10-gallon pot.
More like a 50-gallon pot. Well, maybe a bit smaller. And a proper stone stove as well.
So, there's no way you can do it today?
Absolutely not. We won't have time to make enough stew for everyone. They'll be left frustrated and hungry.
We can't have that happen. What do you suggest then?
My job is cooking, not giving out advice, grumbled Grubber. Just coffee and tea, brewed in all pots. They can be served with honey and molasses. In addition, I can make some quick flatbread, the kind cooked on stones around a fire. They're also called traveler's cakes. They'll pair well with honey and molasses. Oh, I'm sure they'll prove popular. How does that sound?
Sounds great. I'll leave you to it, nodded the dwarf energetically, snatching a thick stick from the ground. I'll be back in 15 minutes. And he rushed off. 15 minutes later, the dwarf returned to the territory of the outpost, flying like a meteor, and galloped back to his own property. Breaking sharply at the gate, he dashed to the market stand, where the convoy men had already started to gather again, wishing to buy something to eat, as well as get more beer, of course.
Bring your own mugs and plates! Bring your own mugs and plates, if possible! Shouted Crow in advance, dumping the foraged items onto the sackcloth beneath the sales table.
The local area had not seen such a rapid butchering of wildlife in quite some time. Rabbits, partridges, bird nests, mushrooms, sticks and stones, jackals, wild onions. The dwarf obliterated everything in his path like a bulldozer. Then he gathered everything into one pile and brought it home. He must not disappoint his customers. But what a lousy day.
Rabbit and partridge meat, fresh meat,
began to list off the player energetically, hitching a bright smile back on his face.
Eggs, wild onions, mushrooms, everything just gathered, firewood at very cheap prices, tea and coffee, 1 mug for 5 coppers, traveler's cakes, fresh out of the oven, 3 coppers per cake, and last but not least, beer, fresh beer, 10 coppers a pint, get it before it's gone.
The people did not keep him waiting, especially once they noticed the magical aroma of baking traveler's cakes wafting through the air. It was a simple dish, and Grubber prepared it masterfully, slapping balls of dough one after another onto the hot and slightly oiled rocks around the flaming hearth. The smell of baking bread knocked people off their feet and caused profuse salivation, while the sight of golden crust filled their eyes with tears. Wallets opened of their own accord, and rough hands grabbed fistfuls of coins, dropping them with a clatter onto the sales table.
5 cakes for me!
Meat and cakes, please! 4 of each! And onions! 3 bunches of onions! And mushrooms, too!
I want some of everything you've got! 10 of each!
I have an order for cakes! 15 of them! Mr. Seller, sir, you wouldn't happen to be selling omelets, eh?
We aren't making omelets yet, yelled back Crow over the clamoring crowd, passing an order.
Who asked for meat?
Me!
1 dozen eggs! Cakes! I want 12! And put some molasses on top! And honey! I like it sweet!
12 pints of beer! I like some beer too!
Beer! Are those bags of oats, Mr. Seller? If so, I'll take a few of them. How much are you selling them for?
Mr. Seller, can we sit on those benches? Or are they just for show?
What benches?
asked the heavily breathing player without stopping as he handed out the ordered food.
Over there!
Behind the gate, on Crow's territory, stood two brand new, very long wooden benches. They looked rough and slightly crooked, but obviously sturdy. Beside them stood Woodman, brushing sawdust off his shirt.
Yes, you can, answered Crow immediately. Go ahead, open the gate and come sit down, dear guests. Savor your beer and comfort. Woodman, thank you.
It was nothing, said the second brother, waving off Crow's thanks. I'm going to construct one more bench. After that, I'll start on making a table. But the tools are a problem.
I'll get you more.
And I'm running out of ingredients, added Grubber,
setting down a plate with a tall stack of freshly baked cakes.
I'll get you everything, repeated his promise Crow. Today, right away. Just give me an hour.
If you say so,
replied Grubber, shaking his head in mild disbelief as he turned back to his task.
Mr. Seller, any eggs left?
Here are the last six.
I'll take them, plus all the cakes you have left, and three bundles of firewood as well.
Meat and beer, 10 of each.
I'll take some mushrooms. Have you got any pickled mushrooms, perchance? Or smoked fish? Goes great with beer.
The gate swung open, and a dozen men poured inside, instantly settling on the two benches that stood facing each other. Each of the convoy men held a mug of beer that sported a thick cap of foam. Another half a minute, and fairly loud small talk started up, followed by snorts and roars of laughter. Freed from the obligation of food preparation, the convoy men relaxed in a simple and carefree manner. Crow continued to dash between the sales table and the supply stash, passing out the remains of provisions, which were quickly running out.
Eggs and mushrooms!
Out of stock, informed the dwarf apologetically.
Huh? Already?
But I do have young potatoes, perfect for baking over the fire.
I'll take 3 dozen potatoes then,
stated a gray-bearded traveler authoritatively.
Go on!
Here you go.
I'd look some potatoes too, 100 or so.
Me too!
Us too! And meat, rabbit meat. We're going to make rabbit stew.
Mr. Seller, do you have carrots, in addition to the onions, eh?
No, I don't. I'm so tired. I think I'm going to collapse.
Cakes, please!
More beer!
Came yells from the direction of the occupied benches.
Isn't there a waiter? Or do we have to go get the beer ourselves?
I...
Master!
Came Serg's distressed yell from the top of the hill.
Save some beer for us, too!
Another person in Crow's shoes would have lost it long ago, exploding like a dangerously volatile potion. But not Crow. He stubbornly continued to work, handing out the requested food provisions, firewood, and beer. He collected the empty mugs and filled them up again. He skillfully tossed cakes onto the platters, spooning molasses and honey on top. In the midst of all this, he still managed to take new orders and answer questions. Soon, he was rewarded with the next achievement. 15 crazy minutes later, the sales began to decline. 5 more minutes, and the spot in front of the market stand was empty. Leaning heavily against the sales table, the dwarf was breathing hard. However, the smile did not leave his face.
Yes, it's difficult. Yes, it's hard work.
But isn't it wonderful? Naturally, he had been busy as a bee, but it was worth it. The provisions he had gathered from the wild had flown off the shelves. He also sold over 200 cakes. Thank God Grubber was quick at his job, even though he couldn't make any special delicacies. As for beer, he was down another 100 liters. 2 barrels that had been half drunk earlier were now completely empty. The convoy men would have drunk more, but Crow did not let them, wisely reasoning that beer was always in demand, and that he shouldn't sell it all in one go. He still had the whole evening ahead of him. Molasses, honey, tea, and coffee got sold too, but not as quickly as the other food. Either not all the convoy men had a sweet tooth, or the weather wasn't conducive to it. In heat, cool beer in a fogged-up mug goes down much better. Speaking of beer, lifting his personal mug off the sales table, Crow took a big sip to moisten his parched virtual throat. He wiped his lips carefully
and only then issued a calm, polite greeting. "Good day to you, Centurion Vurius. Glad to see you've arrived safely. Would you like a drink of beer after your journey? I also have tea and coffee. I can find some honey for you, too." The smiling, black-haired dwarf was addressing a graying veteran in a regular corselet worn over top of chainmail. He was dressed in worn boots and black pants with an old, wide belt of thick leather. On his belt hung a knife and a large purse. From behind his back stuck out two weapon handles, a wide sword and a full metal hammer. The veteran was busy transporting a bag of grain, horse feed apparently, but suddenly stopped and decided to rest when passing by Crow's property. He sighed a couple of times, rubbing his overworked lower back. However, the sack of grain looked tiny compared to the huge hands of the old warrior, which looked like they were capable of breaking an elephant's back in one blow. Considering the type of his weaponry, especially the powerful and heavy hammer, that was probably the case. Power coursed throughout the body of the veteran. There is no way he could have gotten tired from carrying the bag. Also, the look in his eyes was completely unlike that of a regular guard. It was a cold, hard gaze capable of drilling a hole in anything, including the heavens. On top of that, he had a very, very severe expression. The looks on the faces of the new guards running past were far softer and kinder by comparison. They kept throwing glances at the titanic figure of the old warrior. Briefly locking eyes with the friendly dwarf, the veteran grabbed the sack with one hand, swung it effortlessly onto his shoulder, and walked away. He did not utter a single word. Crow likewise decided not to say anything more.
"So this means war."
It was perhaps an overly dramatic statement, but to the dwarf, this was exactly what it felt like. He even thought he heard the faint ring of clashing blades. "Woodman," Crow decided not to call up the craftsman, who was immersed in his work, and chose to approach him instead. "I need your help."
"Right now, or after I finish this bench?"
"Preferably now," sighed the dwarf. "I need to change up and add a few things to the market stand."
"Oh, I can do it, as long as it's nothing too small or detailed."
"It isn't. Look." 10 minutes later, with the help of words and crooked diagrams scratched on the ground, Crow explained what he needed. Without thinking twice, Woodman nodded to show that he was up to the task. What Crow asked was to construct two large, sturdy shelving units on either side of the market table. Each unit was to have 4 shelves. Their backsides would face outwards, thus creating something like walls. The shelving units would be tall, reaching right up to the canopy roof. Inside one of them, the middle shelf was to be especially thick and massive, capable of bearing the weight of 2 barrels of beer. The shelf below it will be for mugs. The rest of the shelves will be taken by various goods. For each type of product, Crow will dedicate its own corner and memorize its placement, so that he will know for sure where everything is. Another row of shelves will be under the sales table. With proper organization, he will be able to fit in quite a lot of things. Woodman requested 30 minutes to finish the bench and received it. Meanwhile, Crow was already calling together the rest of his workers, everyone except Grubber, whom he planned to use solely for cooking duties. The workers, who had come running to him, were not disappointed. Each of them received a mug full of beer. This caused overflowing delight and a storm of assurances that their master was the best one in the area. The compliment was dubious, as Crow was the only master for miles around. Therefore, the player decided not to rest on his laurels. He began to hand out the new technical assignment, telling them to dig here and over here, and so on. For every chosen spot, a thick cross was drawn on the ground. He also indicated the width and depth. He ordered one of the workers to bring over small stones from the stash pile. The laborers finished their beer and got to work. Despite already being run down, Crow did not stop to rest and rushed off to the wood stockpile to get logs. 8 future holes needed 8 logs, thick and sturdy ones, which would become supporting posts for the future canopy. Under the canopy will be benches and tables. That was it. Crow never liked playing tag. He preferred racing games that involved finishing first. Sometimes, circumstances force you to break your own rules. However, you should always strive to return everything back to its regular course. The future restaurant patio would be located away from the main property with the hill. It would be next to the market stand and kitchen, which also needed to be expanded and covered with a canopy. He still had so much work ahead of him. "Bring back the posts and place an order for another delivery convoy," chanted the dwarf, breathing hard and grabbing a log. "Bring back posts and place an order. Oof. Come hell or high water, or vicious centurion, it won't stop us from digging. Oof." The sudden influx of manpower made an impact. However, if all strength gets focused in one spot, gaping holes appear in other parts of the plan. Same here. He had to pause digging the holes for the future pond. Chopping trees, gathering stones, everything was paused. Instead, all efforts were directed towards building the large canopy. This included the main force, the dwarf Crow himself, who was the main cog in this machine. As a result, he did not manage to finish a ton of tasks, but it didn't get him down, as it wasn't in his nature to stay depressed for long. While carrying logs, digging up rocks, supervising the workers, and keeping an eye on the craftsman and cook, the player managed to also look around, scanning the entire territory of the outpost. It was full of bustling activity. 3 dozen guards dashed back and forth without rest. All their actions were aimed towards a certain goal. Among them walked the centurion, whom the dwarf had spotted before, looking like a powerful, fully grown hog among a herd of piglets, or like a gnarled oak towering over young saplings. The entire time Crow watched him, the centurion Vurius did not sit down even once. At the same time, he did not make a single unnecessary move. A similar sight can be easily witnessed during a tour of any real-world factory that is fully automated, where everything is done by programmed robots. It was full of the same accuracy, lack of mistakes, cold rationality, and calculated movements. Interestingly enough, while Daira's widely advertised policies promise the exact opposite, a complete absence of any robotic actions on behalf of the locals who were supposed to behave like normal living creatures. They were capable of getting tired and running out of breath. They were not above spreading rumors at work or drinking a pint of beer while their supervisor wasn't looking. Centurion Vurius, on the other hand, behaved like a cybernetic organism. He watched the ongoings like a cold-blooded machine. Only in the depths of his beastly, predator-like body, one could feel the pulsing fury of a warrior. That's something called a special aura, which surrounded a true master of martial arts. It may sound melodramatic, but it perfectly describes the feelings of the player as he looked at the powerfully built old veteran. The centurion was tough to the bone. He possessed extremely dangerous qualities for civilians who happened to find themselves within his reach. Crow experienced the truth of that very soon, right at the moment when the centurion decided to stop pretending to be a regular soldier. Pointing at the recently built livestock watering well, he gave a loud order that carried across the outpost.
"Tear that down! Clesius, Drotorus, together now, remove it! The watering should be in a different spot."
"Yes, sir,"
chorused 2 burly guards with faces as expressive as solid brick.
"Why, you!"
burst out the dwarf, taken by surprise and unable to believe his ears.
Bam, bam, ba-bam, ba-ba-bam,
and one last crash. Nothing remained of the watering well, except for a rapidly growing puddle of mud.
"Why, that little..."
Crow shook from emotion, but continued to stand on the soil of his property, watching the centurion's next move. It seems the guy is far from finished giving orders. Vurius did not disappoint.
"The pond and fish are unnecessary. First squad, cut off the water supply. Remove the pond. Fill it with soil."
Vurius ordered the pond to be destroyed, along with the fish.
"Why, you..."
inwardly roared Crow in outrage. Outwardly, though, he did not say anything. He only clenched his teeth, feeling like the heroine of a certain old joke, which cited the instructions for female police officers in England. If you are being assaulted by a rapist, try to defend yourself with the club. If that doesn't work, then you must fire 3 warning shots into the air. If that doesn't work, then relax and try to enjoy it. The situation was even worse here. Trying to defend with a club would be totally useless, and he had no weapon to fire warning shots. As for relaxing and enjoying it, Crow did not think himself so proficient in sexual games that he would be able to relax and enjoy seeing the fruits of his hard work get destroyed. But the face of the centurion clearly indicated that he was only waiting for someone to try to contradict him. Crow could not risk a direct confrontation with him, and he definitely must not bring up logical reasons, such as, "The pond is a water reservoir for emergencies," or, "The waterer was fine where it was." This would be seen as trying to bring down a superior in the eyes of his subordinates. It is the worst mistake he can make, which would never be forgiven. He cannot go against him, but doing nothing is unacceptable too. He had to save whatever he can. As the soldiers armed themselves with shovels and dashed towards the pond, which bordered the dwarf's property, Crow did not wait, and, grabbing a pickaxe, bolted in the same direction. He swung the pickaxe and landed a powerful blow on the 3-foot-thick earthen barrier that separated the pond from the freshly dug hole on his property. Thanks to the wild rage that had taken hold of the dwarf, he was making extremely rapid progress. Soon, the first torrent of water surged into the hole that Crow's workers had dug. Several little fish flashed by as they were swept away against their will into their new home. Standing over the gap he had made and continuing to make it wider blow by blow, he glanced at the centurion. Vurius stood with his muscular arms folded behind his back and carefully observed the local citizen's actions. His face was expressionless. Well, not entirely. The corners of his lips were ever so slightly curved in a sarcastic smile. The stream of water flowing into the hole grew stronger, and the future pond began to fill up in front of the dwarf's eyes, as the bewildered fish swam back and forth among the chunks of mud and shreds of weeds. Sighing with relief, the player stepped back. Then he stared again in expectation at Vurius, who had already come right up to the fence surrounding the dwarf's property.
"You are the boss here," noted the centurion.
"Yes, I am," nodded Crow assertively.
"And on the other side of this fence, I am the boss."
"That is none of my business," shrugged the dwarf, deciding to neither agree nor argue with him.
"Exactly. The captain of the previous shift lavished praise on you, foreigner. He listed and described your and the guard's cooperative achievements and agreements. And so, regarding both of those things, I don't like your achievements. But you've already seen that."
The centurion's gaze wandered over the smashed waterer and the empty pond that was draining onto Crow's property.
"I did," nodded the dwarf, keeping an expressionless face. "Your previous agreements are annulled. They don't exist anymore. Algora's guard has no need of your services. We'll manage everything ourselves."
"Right."
"The pond with the fish. You managed to save it. But where will you get fresh water for it?" wondered the centurion.
"The stream?"
"I won't allow digging on the territory of the outpost. I won't allow irrigation ditches through the outpost to bring water to private property. This is Crown land, and if everyone starts digging holes and ditches here, that won't do."
"Right," nodded Crow, growing even more grim.
"That's exactly what I wanted to hear from you, enterprising foreigner."
Centurion Vurius allowed himself a barely noticeable, self-satisfied smirk.
"Don't get in my way, and I won't notice you. Then we'll get along."
"Right." That marked the end of their conversation. As he walked away,
Vurius gestured towards the large campsite that Crow had recently built for the passing caravans and barked loudly.
Tear it down! Second squad!
A couple of minutes later, half of the stone fire pits were destroyed. Black soot hovered in the air, creating something of a morning veil, which was being rapidly swept away by wind. The same wind, changing direction sharply, mockingly ruffled the glum dwarf's black hair, and rushed away, laughing, taking along with itself all of Crow's plans and broken achievements. What did he manage to save? Only the pond, which had half filled the freshly dug hole with murky, foamy water. There was no inflow of fresh water. Very, very soon, the water will evaporate entirely, leaving dying fish on the bottom. He can no longer change the course of the stream to divert water to the pond. The centurion had forbidden such action in advance, and Crow had no way of reversing the decision. The campsite with the fire pits, which was located right in front of the market stand, was destroyed, just like the watering well beside it. No longer will caravans and convoys break camp right here by Crow's lands. They will stop further on, at the place where the new livestock waterer will be built. Nobody could forbid Crow from selling, but the player suspected that the centurion was not finished with him yet. This was just the beginning. The beginning of what, you may ask? The beginning of a real war. The signal to attack had just been given. The dwarf Crow was on defense. On the offense was Centurion Vurius. Find out everything about Centurion Vurius. Absolutely everything. Damn him! Wrote down the player dwarf in his journal, and, after pausing to think, added, everything down to the smallest detail, all of his background, the entire biography from birth. What else? On the next page was a note. Urgent, find a source of fresh water for the pond, or the fish will die. Water, sighed the dwarf. Water. Okay, if I find a way to make water flow into the pond, won't our dearest, damn him, centurion complain about water escaping from my yard and wetting the crown's land and all that? He sighed. What else? Info on the centurion? Info. Okay, I know where to start. 3 minutes later, Crow had departed from the territory of the outpost. He was going on a hunting and gathering trip. Due to the feeling he was experiencing at the moment, he could only rip and kill. Behind him, two workers were hauling buckets of water from the stream to the pond. Crow ordered them to fill it up completely. The rest were helping Woodman finish the large, tall canopy roof intended for the future pub. A new order for food, tools, and materials was already lying inside the mailbox by the entrance gate. Tonight, the mail pelican will carry it back to Algora, and by tomorrow morning or noon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.